because I do believe that God is speaking to us all. And the question usually is not if God is speaking. The question is always, are we listening? And I'm reminded, even as I watched that video, some of you Bible scholars that might be in the room tonight, you know, the Bible is split up into two covenants. There's an old covenant called the Old Testament, and there's a new covenant called the New Testament. And you know, there was a period of time between the Old Covenant and the New Covenant, from the time that the book of Malachi was written to the time that Jesus Christ appeared upon the scene. There was a period of 400 years. And those of you who know Scripture or just things about Scripture, we are told that those 400 years are called the years of silence. 400 years of silence, because we don't have anything supposedly that God spoke during those 400 years. But I assure you, as sure as you are sitting in your seat this evening, that God did speak for those 400 years. I assure you.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. But this is what I believe. This is what I believe. I believe that when God spoke again 400 years later, he had a new birth. He had a new vision. He had a new dream that he wanted to fill the earth with again. Amen. Huh. And this is what I see. And this is what I believe you see as well, because God causes us all to see. I believe that there has been a span of silence. Not that God hasn't spoken, but I believe the span of silence has been that God is ready to birth in the earth now a new dream, a new vision, the beginning of something entirely new that the world has never seen before.
Amen.
I believe that. And that's why the cry is, as we begin tonight, the cry is, God is speaking. You can say he's speaking again. You can say that. The question is, are you listening? Are you listening? And God, listen everybody. God will sometimes speak to you from outside of you. We have talked about this many times. And it's really not even that mysterious. I don't know if some of you have been in your bedrooms at night and prayed the prayer and prayed to God that he would answer your prayer. Is anybody in the house tonight? I could not tell you how many prayers that I have prayed, and I know we are all the same. Well, I have said, Lord, sometimes I have said, Lord, we're friends, right? We're supposed to talk to each other. I talk to you, you talk to me. I said, Lord, I'm listening. And then I'm quiet for about maybe 2-3 seconds. And I say, God, because there's an earnest in my heart that night, God, I'm still listening. Has anyone in this room ever been determined not to sleep at night because they were determined to hear from God? Somebody help me. It's New Year's Eve.
Amen.
Hey,
amen.
Amen. You want him, but he always on time.
All right. And you know, the truth is, God is always speaking. But I also believe that there's a groan inside every one of us because we know there's something more. Does anybody know what I'm talking about?
Amen.
God is faithful and he will speak. Amen, Pastor Phil. But even as he speaks, it's like I'm not completely satisfied because I know there's more. I know there's more. And what I believe part of the year 2014, I believe that even as God began to speak again through the book of Matthew, I believe that God is going to speak again through and from the year 2014. And as we watch the video, there are three primary things that God speaks to us even before he begins to birth new dreams and give us new visions. And the three things are very clear. The first thing he says is this. Listen now, before God wants to give you a new dream, and I believe that God wants to give each and every one of us a new dream. I believe that God wants to give each and every one of us a new vision. And before he does, he kind of like tells you to brace yourself now. Brace yourself. Because he says, you think I've been talking, but I really haven't talked yet. And I think God can say that. Hallelujah, please. Yes. I believe God can bring us to a place where he says, you think I talked to you? You think I showed you something? You think I said something to you? Hold on. Just hold on just a little bit. Because as I'm getting ready to speak again, and I'm getting ready, as scripture says, I'm going to shake the earth and I'm going to shake the heavens. I'm going to speak one more time. Amen. He says, I'm going to speak one more time. And his voice is going to be so loud, and it's going to be so clear. It's going to be as if we've lived in silence. Amen. And he says, to brace yourself, I believe God says three things. He says, number one, he says, get ready. He says, be strong. Amen. Be strong. And God can never tell you that and me that enough. Yeah. I could never hear that from my God enough for him to say, Michael, put your name in that place. Mm-hmm. Be strong. So I say, okay, I think I'm ready. You think you're ready? You think you're ready? Come on now, it's New Year's Eve, let's have a little fun. You think you're ready? I say, okay, Lord, okay, I'm going to be strong. And you know, we're saying that I'm really not strong. Okay, Lord, I'm strong. Like the cowardly lion, I'm strong. We say it and we're shaking and tears are rolling down our face. I'm strong. And because the Lord knows your heart and my heart better than we know our heart itself, he says a similar thing. It's similar to the be strong thing. It's very similar because he knows I'm not quite near there yet. He says, okay, you're strong. Yeah, I'm strong. I'm strong. He says, okay. Number two, he says, be not afraid. Be not afraid. And all of a sudden, it's starting to settle me now. You too? I'm starting to get a little settled. It's like, God, be not afraid. Be not afraid. I'm not quite there yet. I'm not quite there yet, but I'm better.
Amen.
You're with me?
Amen. Amen.
Then it says the third thing to you and me. If it's the ball one at all, the third thing is this. He says, trust in my love. Trust in my love. He says, I love you. I'm not going to hurt you. I'm not going to do anything bad or wrong to you. Do you trust me? He says, trust in his love. And I didn't say trust in him because that becomes a very common phrase. I said trust in his love. Believe that he loves you. Believe he loves you when you wake up in the morning. Believe he loves you when you lay your head on your pillow at night.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Believe he loves you when you think you're doing everything right. You all right? And believe that he loves you when you think you're doing everything wrong.
That's right.
Trust Amen. His love. Breathe in and breathe out. Did anyone do that with me? Yeah. Breathe in and breathe out. Amen. God says, I'm getting ready to speak again. I'm getting ready to speak again. He tells us, be strong, do not be afraid, and trust in his love. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise him. So, as we welcome you to our New Year's Eve service, as this is the night where we finally say goodbye to the year 2013, and I think we handled that well on Sunday.
Amen.
But I tell you what, Sunday from today, I needed those two extra days. Anybody here?
Amen.
I'm going to tell you what I mean. You see, if you were here on Sunday, we said there were some things in 2013 that we wanted to leave in 2013. We did not want to bring it to 2014, okay?
Amen.
Tell you what, but I brought them into Monday and Tuesday. As I left here, it was going to stay here, but I thank God for the, like, the two extra days. All right.
Amen.
Amen, every one of us. Amen, every one of us. Now, as we approach 2:14 and your 2 days are up, I say this. I say, be strong. I say, do not be afraid. And I say, come on, help, trust in His love.
Amen.
Hallelujah. You cannot do it. All right, now. Because you cannot do it, and I cannot do it. I cannot do. 2014 is not about you and I being resolved to do it. It's about us saying finally, hopefully, I can't do it. I can't do it. I can't do it. I can't do it. Anybody with me? I feel like I'm on my own. Just help me out. I can't do it. That's okay. Those are godly words. I can't do it. You want to say this to you? See, I can't do it. Once I start reading it, you're all going to know it. Spoken by the prophet Joel, but these are the words of God. God is speaking. Are you listening? And it came to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit upon, there's two words there, all flesh. God says, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Pastor Phil says it all the time. He will pour out his spirit upon, you say it all the time, all flesh. It goes on to say, it says, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions. Your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions. And even in reference to what we opened up with, I do believe, as we said on Sunday, we took a look back at the year 2013, and there were four events in 2013 that we looked at. If you aren't here, I'm going to tell you what the events were. The first event was we looked at the inauguration of President Barack Obama. That was the first thing we looked at. The second thing we looked at, I believe it was the changing of the priesthood, where for the first time, we did the math by the way, it was for the first time in over 700 years that a pope retired from his position. And we had a new pope, you know his name, I hope, it's Pope Francis I. Amazing. Hasn't happened in over 700 years. So we have the changing of the priesthood. And with the changing of the priesthood, just as the Bible says, it's the changing of everything. Listen now. Look at the spiritual symbolisms that's going on in your world. With the changing of the priesthood, there's a changing of a belief system. And then when you change the way you believe, you're going to change the way you live. I find it, Phil, I find it to be so significant. Anybody with me today?
Yes.
I find it to be so significant. Number three, after we saw the changing of the priesthood, we said, does anybody recall there was a royal birth? After you change the priesthood, it's the picture. If you see it, when the Gospels finally began, after the 400 years of silence, there was a priest. He was doing his priestly duties like they did for 400 years. And suddenly, this is when God's first voice was first heard. After 400 years, God spoke to a priest in the holy place. He said, does anybody know the priest's name? He said, Zechariah. He said, Zechariah. Know it. He said, Zechariah. He said, you're going to have a son. You're going to have a son. You and your wife, Elizabeth. And he said, we can't have a son. We're too old. We can't have a son. He said, you're going to have a son, and you're going to give him a name. And according to Jewish tradition, his name should have been Zechariah Jr. But it wasn't going to be Zechariah Jr. Does anybody know what it was going to be?
John.
Where did you get John from? He said, it ain't going to be Zechariah. It's going to be John. John. So after 400 years of silence, although it wasn't real silence, it's just that you haven't heard nothing yet. God finally spoke again to a priest, and he changed the priesthood entirely. He said, you're going to have a son. His name is going to be called John, because it's a picture of a whole new priesthood.
Amen.
Listen. After there was a changing of the priesthood, there was a royal birth. Does anybody know the name of the king that was born? Well, I'm talking about King Jesus, but we'll get to George. George?
I'm sorry, it's the one that you
hold on to that one. But you know what? Because the parallel was so similar, after the changing of the priesthood, there was given birth to a new king. His name is Jesus. And don't forget the inauguration prior to that, because the inauguration prior to that was that there was Augustine. Augustine rose to power, and Augustine said, okay, we're going to have a census throughout the land. It wasn't a census that they knew every year. So there was an inauguration, there was a census, there was a changing of the priesthood, and then there was a royal birth. Is anybody amazed? Because I'm amazed. The Lord just told me that just now. So let's figure it out. Let's do this together. What was next? Okay. They were all very good. There was a passing. On Sunday, we talked about the passing of President Nelson Mandela.
And with that, I want to say that at the time Jesus was born, and it says that the parents, Joseph and Mary, took Jesus to the temple to be blessed, because, you know, we christened the babies, right? We blessed them. And they brought him to the temple, and there was an old man in the temple. His name was Simeon. Simeon said, I have waited for this day. And Simeon prayed to God that he would not die before he saw that day. So Simeon saw that day before he died. So we have the inauguration. We have the changing of the priesthood. We have the royal birth. And then we have the promise fulfilled and the fading away of the old Lord. Amen? And when President Barack Obama, on January 21st, 2013, and when he was sworn into office, we said on Sunday that he put his hand on two Bibles. Not one, he put his hand
Bibles. Mm-hmm. On the bottom was the Bible that President Abraham Lincoln used. Mm-hmm. Abraham Lincoln, Emancipation Proclamation. On top of his Bible was the Bible of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And he put his hands on both Bibles. And he came into office. And what we saw with President Barack Obama, a man chosen by God, because no one is in office but chosen by God. A man chosen by God. He fulfilled the dream that Lincoln and that Dr. Martin Luther King put into words. I have a dream that one day, President Barack Obama fulfilled that dream. So what do you do when the dreams have been fulfilled? What do you do when the visions have come to pass? Because remember President Nelson Mandela, he put an end to apartheid. Apartheid that went on the continent in Africa. Apartheid is just a word that says we are apart. It's a parthood. It was a separation that was sanctioned by law. By law. The law of Africa sanctioned separation. That's what apartheid was. And Nelson Mandela said, we're not going to have it anymore. He spent 26 years in prison for that. But when he came out, he was elected as president of South Africa.
Hallelujah.
And he put an end to the laws, the legality of apartheid that legalized separation. Yes, he did.
Hallelujah.
Yes, he did. So what do you do? What do you do when the dreams have been fulfilled, when the visions have manifestation? What do you do? What do you do? You know what to do. God is going to speak again. He's going to do something powerful in the earth again today. He's going to speak, and the question is, are you listening as if you will not hear his voice? Because God, at this time, is going to birth again new dreams and new visions. Because the old dreams and the old visions have come to pass. Can I get a witness? And that's why God said 2013 was a powerful year. It was a year like no other year. Do you remember 1 year ago today when we spoke those words? And in that year, the dreams have been fulfilled, the visions have become manifest. And then in the year 2014 and beyond, God says, I'm getting ready to speak again. I'm getting ready to speak again. He says, I'm going to give you new dreams.
Amen.
And I'm going to give you new visions.
Praise God.
And it's going to be something that no one has ever thought of before and ever heard of before. It's not improving the old. It's something entirely new. It's time for a new dream. It's time for a new dream. And that's what God is birthing in the earth. And he gives us the dreams. The dreams are given to us. You see, there is a difference between dreams and visions. See, the dreams are given to us when we're still in the old world, when we're still in our darkness, when we're in our slumber. The dreams are given to us. The dreams are given to us. And if any one of you have ever had a dream, the dreams are the ones that seem to be impossible to be fulfilled. You know? That's what a dream is. A dream is like, it's like wishful thinking.
Yep.
It's like, this is my dream. Has anyone ever had a dream? Anybody?
Hallelujah.
And right at the beginning, the dream is something that you think will never, never, ever happen. The dream seems to be impossible. And those great men and women that have gone before us, that God birthed inside of them a dream. You know, first you have the dream and it's inside of you. You don't dare speak it for a while. You know that, right?
Amen.
Yeah, you know.
Yeah.
How many of you had dreams, you know, spiritually or actual dreams that you dare not speak? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Because they start from inside of you. It's something that the world has never heard before. And you say, I can't say this. No one has ever said it before. A dream is a new thought, a new idea that seems to be impossible. And the truth is, the dream is impossible to be fulfilled in our old world. It is. The dream is impossible to be fulfilled in our old world. That's why what God has to do is bring in a new.
Amen.
Because the new dreams, they can't go in the old world. That's why they seem impossible. You need a whole new world. Anybody got a wow in the house?
Wow.
We need a whole new world. But the beginning is a dream. And every single one of you, listen, God is speaking. He's speaking to you from inside of you. He's going to tell you something that has never been told before. Make you think of something that has never been thought before. He's going to birth a new dream in the earth today. And it's done through people. It's done through people. Does anybody look at the massive figures in history and say, wow, they are massive figures in history? But does God ever just give you a glimpse and say, they're just like you?
Yeah. Yeah.
No different from you. No different from you. Amen?
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah.
He's going to give you a dream. He's going to give me a dream. He's going to give us a dream. God is going to speak again, and he's going to bring a new dream into the earth. Because the old dreams and the old visions have been fulfilled. Amen?
Yes.
Now, a dream is of a world that does not exist yet. He's got to birth a whole new world. It's seemingly impossible. It's wishful thinking. It is something that only exists. The dream is something at first that only exists in our hearts and our minds. Can anybody relate to something like that? Does anybody have a dream, whether it be personal or global? Does anybody have a dream that seemingly, it's only in our hearts and minds, but seemingly impossible?
Amen.
I told my brother Phil I wasn't going to raise my hands today because his tux is tight, but I got it. Yeah, it starts in your hearts, everybody. It starts in your minds. Oh, I love the Lord Jesus, and he's so good to us. We live in extraordinary time. And I believe his word to be true, and I know that God put us on the earth for this time. Because I believe God has spoken three things to me, and he's spoken it to you. And I say, I am ready, and you say,
I am ready.
I say, I am ready, and you say,
I am ready.
I say, I am ready, and you say,
I am ready.
That's right, because I am strong. I am not afraid, and I trust in his love. Come on, is anybody with me? Listen, God has spoken these words to us during our 400 years of silence. He has spoken it to me, and he has spoken it to you. He has said these words to you over and over and over again, and I have these words in my spirit, and so do you. I say this, I say, I am strong, and you say,
I am strong.
I say, I do not fear,
and I trust in his love.
Amen. We are ready. We are ready to have the new dream. We are ready. Oh, praise the Lord. It's going to take a whole lot of strength. It's going to take a whole lot of strength. Now, I want to tell you a little bit of difference between dream and vision. Because, listen, come on now. The vision is just one step past the dream. The dream says it's impossible. But you know what happens? You know what happens. The dream starts to linger around some strength and some not fearing and trusting in his love. And after we say those things again and again, are you with me? And after you believe those things again and again, oh yeah, after those words go on again and again and again and again, I stop saying it's impossible. I start grabbing hold of a vision. And I say, hey, hey, we can do this. We can make this happen. I say it's not impossible. It will be done if it's the last thing that I do.
Amen.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yes. I think it's awesome.
during a 400 years of silence, I believe that there were three things going on. Be strong, do not be afraid, and trust in my love. So when the scene comes along, we're already like a step ahead. We've already gone from dream to vision, where we say, this ain't possible, we can do this.
Amen.
We can do this. And I'm going to tell you the God's honest truth. I can't do it, and you can't do it. Impossible, but we can do this. Can I get a witness?
Amen.
I'm going to say it again. I can't do this. You can't do this. But we can do this. I can't do it alone. And neither can you. We need to trust each other. We need to love each other. We need to help each other. Because listen, we're not getting through this life alone. Has anybody come to the epiphany that I can do this?
Hallelujah.
And whatever that thing is, things. I can't do this. But the dream turns into a vision, and I say, but we can. But we can. But we can. Because you make me stronger, and you make me stronger. And you make me strong.
Yes.
I'm not done. Because you take my fear away. You take my fear away. And then I start to trust in your love.
Amen.
I know we all trust the invisible God. How about the flesh God?
Amen.
Christ. I start to trust again. And I know there's a million reasons that you can say why you don't trust mankind and the love of each other. But for 400 years, God is going to say that he's been saying, trust my love. And after the 400 years of silence, I say, I trust that you love me.
Hallelujah.
I trust that you love me. I trust that you love me. I trust that you love me when I do everything right, and I trust that you love me. I know you do. I do everything wrong. I trust our friendship that when I say the right thing to you, you love me, and I trust our friendship that when I say that's the wrong thing to you, you still love me.
Yes.
I trust that when I try to do everything right, I hurt you and I betray you. I'm sorry. But I trust that you still love me.
Yes.
Because the truth of the matter is, let me tell you something, I can't do this, but we can.
Yes, that's right.
Hallelujah.
We can. We can. There is no I. I is weak. We are strong.
Praise God.
There's so much hidden that we need each other. We will love each other. Listen. We will love each other. We will not judge each other. Love and kindness will bring perfection. Trust that, okay?
Amen.
You with me? Trust it. We will love each other. Listen to me. Here's a big one. Here's a big one. You ready?
Yes.
Who said that? This one person's ready.
Yes.
Every one of you ready?
Yes.
We're ready.
Yes.
Okay.
Listen, we're going to stop talking about each other. Okay? We're going to stop laughing at each other. If you think I'm looking at you, yes, I'm looking at you. I'm looking in the mirror, too. You hear me?
Amen.
Because I can't do it. And when I tear you down to exalt me, I got one place I'm headed for, failure.
Amen.
So I can't let you fail, and you can't let me fail. You can't let me fail. You need me. But I can't let you fail. I can't let you fail. Because I can't win without you.
Amen.
Because I can't do it. And you can't do it. We can do it.
Yes, we can.
Amen.
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 Yes, we can.
Okay?
guest weekend. Wow. Question.
The difference between the dream and the vision. When we start to believe the impossible, it says we can do this. It is possible. Amen.
Amen.
And the vision starts to get out of what's in our minds and starts to put it in our lives. Where it's no longer something we think about, something we live. Amen. Got a couple of points I want to share with you. You guys all right?
Yeah.
Night ain't going nowhere. When I'm done, we're going to show another video. We might stand for a second or two. This is like a break, you know. I'm not going to let you go on the foyer because you might not come back. Go on the foyer, flash the lights on. I'm sure half of you will come back in. But we'll stay here for our break. Let me tell you something. Dreams and visions, they really can't be taught. Dreams and visions, they arise from an energy from inside of you. It's something that God gives you from inside of you. You cannot be taught the dream, and you can't be taught the vision. I can't give it to you by my words, but the words can cause something inside of you to wake up, though. The dream and the vision comes from an energy inside of you. God is speaking. Are you listening?
Yes.
Amen.
And we will have to create a whole new environment to bring this vision. We're going to need a whole new world to make our dreams and visions come to pass. Now, I want to end with our bulletins. Let's see. Does everybody have your bulletin for this evening?
Mm-hmm. Happy New Year, everybody.
Happy New Year. Open it up. Let's go over the order of service.
Okay, after me.
No. Have you examined it? You got it down pat? Okay, good. Turn the page. Never mind who's next. Okay. Second page. Our year is this, true victory. This is what true victory is. True victory is when everybody has victory. That's true victory. True victory is what Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. said. True victory is what Abraham Lincoln said. True victory is what President Nelson Mandela said. He said it's only truth when everybody has victory, not just when some people have victory. All have to have the victory. Otherwise, it's not true victory. You see, with God, it's only true victory when everybody wins. Only when everybody wins is that the God kind of victory. Now, you and I, and the earth, and the human thinking, we don't know that kind of victory. We don't know it. You put two guys in a boxing match, someone has to lose, and somebody has to win. But that's not true victory according to God. You got two nations going together head to head. One has to rise, and one has to fall. But according to God, that's not true victory. And we see it throughout the earth. We've seen all of our wars. We've seen the great wars. We've seen World War I, World War II. We've had D-Day, Victory Day, right? But it's not true victory. It's not true victory because somebody lost. Somebody lost. Somebody died. Somebody got hurt. It's not true victory. Only God, only a God that is absolutely beyond your imagination can give you and I a true victory where nobody loses. Do you hear me? Nobody loses. Because let me tell you something about the old world and the old way of thinking. In my old way of thinking, I thought victory was when some went to heaven and some went to hell. But that's not true victory because all don't have victory. Is anybody going to give me an amen?
Amen.
Is anyone going to give me another amen?
Amen.
Is anyone going to give me a hallelujah?
Hallelujah.
That's not true victory. That's a victory that only you and I can think of. Somebody has to lose. But God says, I'm going to give you something that no man can give you. How about this? How about this? How about everybody wins?
Amen.
How about everybody wins?
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. How about the verse spoken by the prophet Joel that says, I will pour my spirit out on how much? All. How much? All. How much? All flesh. Yeah. True victory. True victory. True victory. It's the whole. It's not when the Americans lose. Oh, well, the Americans lost nearly. I'm just curious. True victory is not when the Americans win and the Russians lose. Anybody in the house? True victory is not when the Americans win and Iraq loses. No, 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 no. Be a hard one to swallow, but no. True victory is not when America wins and China loses.
No, 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 that's man.
True victory is when, believe it or not, I don't know if I believe it, when all win. When Russia and China and Iraq is not the enemies of God. Man, hold on to your seats. Are you strong? Are you afraid?
No.
Do you trust his love?
Yes.
The Muslims are not God's enemies. Still in your chair? I just said Muslim, but you know, there's a thousand other titles that we do. Right?
Yeah.
You see, God can't give you a dream until he first says, be strong, don't be afraid. You trust my love? You trust my love? You trust my love. Because get ready for this. I love everybody, God says. Yeah. I love everybody.
Amen.
He says, I love everybody. I died for everybody. I forgave everybody's sins. Forgiveness of sins is not a work of man. It's a work of God. What do you think? What do I think? We need to deserve forgiveness of sins. Father, forgive me for I have sinned. That didn't get it to you. He gave it to you. That just gave you some kind of understanding that you have it. You have it because he gave it. And you know, I was just talking with somebody, and you guys probably had this conversation like I had. Has anyone ever asked you what's the unforgivable sin? What is the unforgivable sin? What sin is not forgivable? Has anyone ever asked that? Well, maybe has anyone ever faulted? Don't raise your hands. Which sin does God not forgive? Which is the unforgivable sin? And I say this. Well, how about this? Let's take this into consideration. How about the people who killed the Son of God? The people who killed the Son of God. If that sin is forgivable, then everything else is less than that. And I think of the people that killed God. I just like to say it that way. The people that killed God. The people that killed God. If there's an unforgivable sin, that's the one as far as I'm concerned. Not what you did last week. Last month, last year. I'm sorry. I will make light of it in the presence of his forgiveness. Because if the people who killed God, when Jesus was on the cross, he said this. He said, you know it. He said, Father, forgive them. Because they don't know what they're doing. Forgiveness is an act of God. What on earth makes us believe it's an act of man? Forgiveness is an act of God. He said, forgive them. They were forgiven, washed in the blood, saved because of Jesus. It's an act of God. True victory is victory for
all of us.
All of us. Amen to that. So with your paper here, look at this. Number one, I got 4 points, and I closed the poem. No poem. Okay, it says this, a definition of this dream, this true victory. We believe this true victory is the life lived no longer unto ourselves, but for others. This is what true victory is. You no longer live for yourself. We've lived in a world where you live for yourself. True victory does not look for, listen now. It's not when I'm happy. True victory is when you're happy. True victory is when my life is making sure, not that I'm rich, but I make sure that you're rich.
Hallelujah.
True victory is not when I make sure, I got some things listed here. It's not when I make sure, that I'm strong. I'm going to make sure you're strong. Right. True victory is not when I want to make sure that I'm heard. True victory is when I am willing to close my mouth. Okay, now's a good time. So true victory. is when I am ready to close my mouth. Because I say, hey, why don't you be heard today? I don't have to be the loudest voice in the room. Let somebody hear your voice today. How about this one? Are you ready? Are you ready? Are you strong? Are you not afraid? Do you trust his love? How about this one is true victory? True victory is when I'm not important.
Amen.
It's when you're important. When you are significant and I am in the shadows. And everyone says this for themselves, okay? This is true victory. This is true victory. True victory, listen now, come on, this is real. True victory is not when I make sure I'm liked. True victory is when I make sure that somebody likes you at my cost if necessary. True victory is not me making sure that I'm loved. True victory is willing to not be loved so that you can be loved. Anybody in the house?
Amen.
Now let's take that one step forward, because sometimes we think True victory is, okay, I'm rich now, I'm going to make sure you're rich. No, true victory is when you're poor, you make sure somebody else is rich at your expense.
Amen. Right.
True victory is when you give all your wealth to somebody else is rich. True victory is when you give your happiness for a moment to somebody else is happy. True victory is when somebody else is important, when you are overlooked. It's not the surplus of what you got, it's what you got instead of you getting it. Sounds still, does it still sound okay?
Yeah!
Yeah, because I can't move on. That's true victory. That's right. Okay, number two, what's your second bullet point? It says, we believe true victory has met our needs and has established a new vision. A vision to see the needs of others and lift them up. We said it's time for a new dream. It's time for a new vision. You see, the old vision was this. The old vision was concerned about the salvation of one. Primarily and foremost, the salvation of me. I got to make sure I'm saved. Yeah, that's an old vision. It's an old vision. It's about me making sure I'm secure, making sure I'm met. That's the old vision. The new vision is this. It's like the one for all for one, the three in one, however you want to say it. The new vision is this. It's not that I'm saved. It's not that I'm saved. The new vision is this. Listen, we're saved. Where's that? It's not one, it's all. It's not me, it's us. Amen?
Amen.
We believe the time has come to build, or the time has come now, to build our own houses. But it's to build the house of the Lord. And we have said it, but let us say it again. In the years that this earth has experienced such poverty and however you want to put it, recession, what do you call it? Fiasco, the end of my life? I don't know what word you put to it.
Depression?
You know, God ordained that. We all know that now, right? Now, yeah. Because remember the time of Joseph, God said, I'm going to bring 7 years of famine in the land. I'm going to bring 7 years of famine. You couldn't stop that. And then it was time for plenty. God says this. He says, I'm going to turn the tides again. I'm going to speak again. Is anybody listening?
Amen.
He says, I'm going to speak again. Is anybody listening?
Amen.
He says, I'm turning the tides. But guess what? Now, you don't build your house. You build the Father's house.
Amen.
You build somebody else's house.
Amen.
Maybe you go without a house for a while so somebody else can have a house. Maybe you go without a car for a while so somebody else can have a car. He's going to rebuild us. He said he would rebuild us, but he didn't say he's going to rebuild me. He's going to rebuild me. He's going to rebuild us.
Hallelujah.
And look at that last point there. It says, we believe the love of God will strengthen us. It will give us the strength to meet the needs for all to live in true victory. Now, I'm going to say one thing about the strength. This is what the strength is. I'm closing with this, so I'm going to ask you for your attention just for one more minute. You want to pause and look at Mary? We can do that together.
Happy New Year, everybody.
We're going to pause and take our attention, right? But yeah, I got you. I love you, Mary. So.
Well, thank you.
Okay, you ready? This is what strength is. It's not the strength to act. God is not giving us the strength to act. It's the strength. I've got to make sure I got the word right. He's giving us the strength of will. Ready? It's the strength to surrender.
Hallelujah.
It's the strength of will to surrender. True victory is the strength. This is true strength, by the way. It's to give up you and what's yours. It's to surrender you. And you need strength for that. Can I get a witness?
Amen.
And only God can take us out of our human nature of self-preservation, and only God can cause us not to preserve ourselves, but preserve somebody else. Amen?
Amen.
I'm going to stand in just 1 second. This is our intermission. Praise the Lord. I'm going to say a prayer. And if you would, why don't you pray with me? Lord, we believe that you said you're going to speak again into the earth again. And we know that we are the earth that you're going to speak into. So the question is this, are we listening? And we say with one voice, I'm going to need your help, we say with one voice, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, we are listening. And we say with great joy and with great anticipation, we say, Lord, hey, give us a new dream. Give us a new vision. Ha. And of course, we need a whole new world for that dream to live in. And everybody says,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Why don't you say hello to your neighbor next to you? Hello, how you doing? Wish him a happy new year. Happy new year.
Happy new year.
Don't go nowhere.
Happy new year. Happy new year. Wish everybody a happy new year. Happy new year.
Everybody. We're going to go black and we're going to watch the video here. You're going to see the title of this video. It's Moving Forward. Moving Forward. And Pastor Phil is going to tell you about Moving Forward. Amen.
When my brother was preaching, I thought, the heart of the Father, that's what I saw. I mean, I heard the message, brother. But I saw the heart of the Father. That's what I saw. The heart's coming with us. Because listen, heart trumps everything. Every time. Fancy messages, prayers, you know, wonderful anointing lines. They're all great. But heart will trump it every time. The heart of God. And I thought of the heart of the Father, and I thought, you know what? We have a lot of parents in here, and I tell you often I'm a father. I have three wonderful children. And I was absent the day they handed out the book, How to Be a Parent. Was anybody else?
Yeah.
Most of us were absent the day they handed out that book, right? But you all think, you know, just like me, you know, my parents raised me, but I'm going to do it better than them. I'm going to do this and this and this, and you all plan, right? Wait, listen, they were jacked up. So you're going to plan it all out. But I remember when I had my first child, my daughter Felicia, and I think it was Mother's Day, and being a good father, I took my daughter to the mall, Edison Mall here actually at the time, we lived here in Fort Myers, and I actually went to Birdines. It's no longer there, I think it's Macy's or whatever, but it was Birdines at one time. And I think she was about three. And we were going to get like a little charm from the from the jewelry counter there. And so she's running around like a typical three-year-old in between the clothing racks and all. And so I'm like, all right, get over here. And then she's going to drift off. You know, listen, I know I wasn't a good father when it came to that because, you know, the kids are running around. I don't pay attention. So I'm talking to the lady, trying to get the charm. But then next thing I know, I hear her crying. And I thought, oh, she must have banged her head or fell or whatever. And I turned. And I see my daughter crying, and I see this security guard, he's about 6'5", probably 270 pounds, basically yelling at her. Now, I had never experienced this. I'm a new dad, I'm a young dad, right? But what do you think dad did? I mean, the adrenaline, I thought my head was going to pop. I'm like, ah! The guy sees me, and then I go racing towards him. Now, this guy's got me, like I said, he's bigger than me, much bigger than me. He's actually running from me. We are in Birdines. We're running, and I'm chasing after this guy. My daughter's standing there crying, and I'm chasing after this guy. Finally, another guy comes over. The manager comes over. They're like, listen, I calm down. I grab my daughter. They're like, listen, you take your daughter, take your gift, and get the heck out of this. We don't want to see you no more. But I remember when I left that thought, I had never, ever had that feeling. Just the protective instinct of a father. Because I had never been in that situation where I saw my child was threatened. And of course, the heart of the father is to protect, to provide, and to love for their children. And I believe that's the heart of the father. I believe it's the same heart that God talks about in Romans. He said, listen, my love I shed it abroad in your hearts. Which means then we can love just like God. You mean more than just my children? Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I can love my children like that, but then I can love you like that. I can love my neighbor like that. Maybe that person at work that I'm not that crazy. I can love them just like that. Now, I know it doesn't make sense, but that's what God said, and so I believe it, and so I know that I can love like that. I can live like that. But that's the heart of the Father. So the heart of the Father is coming with us. Amen?
Amen.
Because our heart will always trump, and it's the ability to love. But I do want to talk a little bit about, moving forward. You know, and there are times in your life where you feel like you're moving forward pretty good, and then there are times in your life where maybe you're feeling a little tired, and you just kind of, do that, you're kind of sluggish. But you have to move forward. And I do believe once you have this vision and you have this dream, and it does start there, I do believe that. You got to believe that you can do it. You got to believe you got enough strength in you to do it. And then when stuff happens, crazy stuff happens, and stuff that just doesn't line up with your vision, you can't be afraid and just say, tapping out. Mm-hmm. You got to realize no and hold on and say no. And then, you do have to trust in His love. I like that. In His love. Because if I know how much He loves me, then when these circumstances arise in my life, I know His love. And that's what I got to look to. Instead of the circumstance, I look to the love, the Father's heart. And so you got to know His love. You got to know the heart of the Father. But you do have to move forward. You do have to move forward if you want the victory. Anybody want the victory?
Amen.
All right, then you have to move forward for the victory. I thought about the account with the Gideon and his 300 men, and they were actually going, God tells them to go against the Midianites. And he has this one battle, and he takes out some of the Midianites, and he takes out a couple of the princes.
But he didn't get all of them, and he didn't get the kings. The men are tired, they've been battling, and they didn't want to move on. And so Gideon said, okay, relax, chill, gave him some bread. He said, okay, now you got to pursue. Because it's not finished. We got to move forward. This thing's not done yet. And of course, you know, the bread, it's the word of God. It's being renewed. And the word of God will give you that strength. It will renew you. The battle is real. They needed to be renewed. They needed to be strengthened so that they can move forward and finish this thing. It wasn't done. And what do? They, of course, go on, and they kill the two kings, and they destroy all the Midianites. Midianites, of course, we're talking about the strife in your life, and you do have to get it. How are you going to get rid of them? Kill them. With the word of God. That's how I'm going to have the strength to get rid of the strife in my life. Because otherwise, without it, I won't. And then it's whatever. And listen, strife can show up in the simplest of any situation, pretty much every day, really. Why do you think of a battle in the Midianites so often? Because there's strife, there's everyday living, it's just life, man. And that's what he's showing you there. And then I was reminded of actually David's mighty men. You know, we've talked about a lot of David's mighty men. And, you know, I think it's in Samuel somewhere. He talks about the 37 mighty men. But there were three that they were the baddest dudes of them all. It was kind of like, you know, Iron Man and the Hulk and like Superman, you know? I mean, Thor's good, you know. Batman, he's got some tricks and some toys and stuff. But listen, if you're going to have a battle, you need the Hulk, you need Iron Man, you need Superman. Any kid will tell you that. Right? I mean, you might win without those guys. Well, David had these three men, the three mightiest of his men, and one of them was Eleazar. And Eleazar, when the Israelites had left, it said that he arose and he pursued the Philistines. And he took them out. But he said he got weary and he was tired, but he kept battling and he kept fighting. And it said that he clave his sword. And when you look up that word, it says it was like it was glued to his hand. I mean, he was holding that sword so tight. You ever get like a muscle cramp? He couldn't even let go of it. That's how hard he was holding on to that sword. And he destroyed all the Philistines. See, David killed one Philistine. Goliath, he was a Philistine. One. Eleazar took them all out by himself.
Amen.
Why? Because he clung to this sword. And he wouldn't let go of it, man. And he took them all down. And it said he pursued. He moved forward. He didn't wait for the battle to come to him. No, man. I'm going to the battle. And the giants, you know, they're just the giants inside of here. It's in your head. It's just a picture. But what do you got to claim? What do you got to hold like glue?
A Bible.
Amen. Question for the group tonight. Anybody ever sleep with their Bible?
I do.
Yeah, I remember I fell asleep one time. I was reading the Bible. I woke up in the morning. It was right there by my face. Yeah, you hold on to that. You'll defend anything. The Word of God does it. The Word of God. Without it, going to be kind of tough to take down those Philistines. It's going to be kind of tough to move forward. But with it, you will.
Amen.
I cling to the Word of God, man. I cling to it. I know it's truth. I know I can live my life in it with the Father's heart, with the love, with the kindness, and yes, like my brother said, it is for all. I'll show you a million verses that show all.
Hallelujah.
But you got to move forward. You got to move forward. But I believe that's what God is doing, and I believe that's what God is also birthing in us and showing us, and that is the true victory. The Bible talks about victory. There's about 12 different verses in the Bible that talk about victory. We've already mentioned a couple of them. But I'd like us to share one, and unlike my brother the heathen, I'm going to read the Bible. I'm kidding. So I'm in 1 John chapter 5, verse 4. And it says, "For whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world, and this is the victory that overcometh the world, our faith." What is the victory?
Our faith.
Our faith. And what do we do though? We overcome what? The world. The worldly thinking. That's the victory. I'm not influenced by the world. I'm not influenced by my desires. I'm influenced by what? The will of the Father. Not my will, but His be done. And that's the victory that he's talking about here. Verse 5. "Who is he that overcometh the world?
But he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God. Now he did say who. It is a question. Who? There's only one. It is the Spirit of Christ that's inside of you. There is only one.
Hallelujah.
There's nobody else. There's no other way. It's just by Christ and Christ alone. That is the one, the only one. Verse 6. This is he that came by water and blood. Even Jesus Christ was not water only, but by water and blood, and is the Spirit that beareth witness, because the Spirit is truth. Now I remember when he was baptized in water, but it also says he was done, it was also with water and blood. Now I believe water and blood, I'd like us to turn there, it's one verse. And sometimes when you see it, when you see it for yourself, I believe sometimes it just jumps out at you. Look at John 19, verse 34. And if you don't have it, I'll read it. John 19. Now this is the account where Christ is now on the cross. And he's already taken his last breath. And he has already said, it is finished. And then one of the soldiers, it says here in verse 34, but one of the soldiers with a spear pierced his side, and forthwith came there out blood and water. Now, he said it is finished. What is finished? It means it is completed. The work is completed. Jesus Christ does the work. We don't do the work. You can't do it. It's only by God and God alone that does it. It's his divine nature that did this thing. It is completed. That means he was the first Adam and the last Adam. Adam is now dead. I believe that water and that blood, it was significant of the resurrection life. It was birth. Jesus Christ is the only one that can birth the Spirit inside of you, and that's what he did on Calvary. Adam was no more. Now what? Now there's resurrection life. He rose from the dead, resurrection life, blood and water. And I believe that's what John... Now remember, John is saying this. John is also the one that was there at the cross when he saw this thing go down. He had firsthand knowledge. Now I believe it was the Spirit of God that revealed it, but he also saw it. He was there at the cross. And now he's telling everybody here in John 5, listen guys, this is the Spirit. It's the only one. Who? The only one. It was birthed inside of you. It was the water. The water is the word of God. That's what cleanses us. And then what? And then it's this resurrection life. He births it in you. Amen?
Amen.
All right, let's go back to, we'll go back to 1 John 5 again. And it says this, for there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, the Holy Ghost. These three are one. Amen? In heaven. But then he says what? And then there are three that bear witness in the earth, the Spirit, the water, and the blood. And these three agree in one. Now what is that? Well, that's just you and I. Okay. Once he births the Spirit in us, and of course there is in heaven, right? And we know where heaven is, it's inside of us. But then what did he do? He birthed it in you and I, in the earth. And I believe that what he's saying right there, the Spirit, the water, and the blood, it's the resurrection life. The blood can always mean death or it can mean life. But in this case, we're talking about life. It's the resurrection life in you and I. But I believe it's mind, body, and spirit. The three are one. That word agree, it's actually not agree. It says, it's actually the Isis. It's actually the one. We are one. That death that he died for all. Romans says that as well. So there's nothing else. That nature is not even real. And so what's the victory? It's victory is just doing what Jesus said. Just follow me. Just live the life that I've already given you. The three are one. And then verse 9, what does it say? If we receive a witness of men, the witness of God is greater. We all receive witness from men. Well, the witness of God is greater. What's he talking about? The witness is the Spirit of Christ. That's what he just said. It's greater than man. I don't care what man says. Yeah, okay, that's a witness. But God's greater. Because sometimes man will say, well, that can't be true. But God's greater. He's the greater witness. The witness of God. And what's the witness? Well, let's go back to John. John 20. Now, this is Christ after he has been resurrected, right? He died, it was finished, now he's been resurrected. Now he's appearing to the disciples. And he says this, and when he had so said, he showed them his hands and his side. Then were the disciples glad when they saw the Lord. Man, I'll be glad too, amen. What I love here, though, is, again, he showed them what? His hands and his side. And, of course, he didn't show them the feet. So there's got to be significance because the feet were pierced to the cross, but he didn't show them the feet. But the hands are always significant of the work. See, he completed the work. See, it's finished, guys. I finished the work. See, guys? You see the side? I've already birthed the Christ. You see it? It's already birthed inside of you. Now, the feet, I'm not showing you the feet. You know why? Because you're going to move forward. The walk's never finished. The walk is never finished.
Amen.
You move forward. Because then what does Jesus Christ say? Now we hear the words of Christ. Then said Jesus to them again, "Peace be unto you. As my Father hath sent me, so send I you." Disciples. Do I have any disciples in the house?
Amen.
We got a couple hands. Thanks for the Two disciples. Come on.
Yeah.
So send I you. That's the moving forward. But Christ has already done the work. But he doesn't need us to move forward. He does need us to move forward. Amen?
Amen.
And what's the moving forward? It'd be a lot of things. But I believe it's what Luke talks of, what Jesus Christ, the only scripture that he actually read in church, which was Isaiah 61. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He hath anointed me to do what? Preach deliverance. To heal the brokenhearted. To set at liberty them that are bruised. And to preach what? The acceptable year of the Lord. Will anybody accept 2014 as the year of the Lord? But you got to go forward. And then after he said that, Jesus breathed on him, he says. He just breathed on him. I send you, and I'm sending you out, listen, with a mighty power. I'm sending you out with my very Spirit. The same Spirit that raised me from the dead, now it dwells in you. So send I you. But we got to move forward. The walk's not done. The walk's never done. And what do we do? We walk for him. It's just like my brother said. I don't walk for myself. I walk for others. How do you heal the brokenhearted? Okay, go find somebody to love. Hug them. Tell them you care about them. How do you preach deliverance to the captives? Let them know that they're loved. Let them know that Jesus already paid the price. Let them know it's a finished work. There's nothing for them to do. How do you set them at liberty that are bruised? You tell them that they have the mind of Christ. Those thoughts of Those are not real thoughts. If they have anything other than the mind of Christ, that's Adam's thoughts. That Adam's gone. That was the last Adam was on Calvary 2,000 years ago. Let me tell you what the mind of Christ says. The mind of Christ says you're lovely, you're pure, you're noble, you're righteous. Now I can fix the bruised head. It's just everything. It's the life of Christ. It's everything he did. So send you. I'm going to ask the worship team if they'll come up. We do have to move forward. I mean, knowledge without application is really worthless. It's just a bunch of nothing. But once I know it, once I believe it, and once I feel it, and then at birth it, then it becomes real in this earth. The same earth that John just talked about.
Faith without works is dead.
Amen. Faith without works is dead. That's right. Somebody go walk it out. Somebody go send the gospel. Somebody go heal the brokenhearted. Amen?
Amen.
Just stand while we close out with this.